Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Paul Gordon, and I'm with iState.tv, and you are watching headlines you may have missed for January 12th, 2018. And this episode is called The Skype President. On this episode, we're going to be, we're going to be talking about the Skype President of Catalonia, FCC's anti-monopoly moves, Bitcoin loves lasers, gun control doesn't pay, the great Bitcoin rush, and more on this episode of Headlines That You May Have Missed. And if you watch the show before, you know what we do here. We look at, we're not necessarily looking for the top headlines, the stories that everybody else is talking about. And these aren't even the top headlines that you'll find on iState.tv. These are the lesser headlines, although some of them are quite important, at least by my assessment. So these are like the lesser headlines that, you're much more likely to not have heard of, although every once in a while we throw in some big headlines in there anyway. So it's not a hard and fast rule, but generally that's what we follow. And we have a bunch of headlines lined up, and what we do is we see how many we can get through in the span of a 20-minute period of time, and we have a clock, and that clock is about to start right now. Get to our first headline here. Will Puigdemont become the lead by Skype president of Catalonia? After all the dust is settled, at least after the most recent assaults on Catalan sovereignty by Madrid, despite the best efforts by Madrid to force and or convince Catalans to reject independence, it seems the Catalans have not only continued to embrace independence, they are set to re-elect the leaders now in exile for fear of being arrested by Madrid operatives and charged with treason. So the question asked here is this: can these exiled leaders of the independence movement lead from a remote location? And the TLDR answer is yes. Yes, they can. And it's called Skype. For a little bit more detail, this story is from Slate.com. And I want to remind you, if you go to hisheadlines.com, you can find all the archives of this show. And on the archives, you can find links to all the stories that we talk about on the show, as well as the ones we don't get to. So from Slate, on Tuesday, the victorious parties agreed to once again elect Puigdemont as regional president. Oh, that's got to burn. The problem is if he sets foot in Spain, he'll be arrested. And traditionally, the leader would appear in person in parliament to present himself and his program for a vote. But Puigdemont's backers say there's no reason he can't do that through a delegate, or better yet, through Skype. But the issue isn't just a squaring in, given that Spain is unlikely to drop the charges against Puigdemont anytime soon. He'll have to keep governing via Skype and email indefinitely. And there's more to it. I have a little bit more of the excerpt on the site, and then you can click on the Slate link to read even more. But I think you get the general gist of it, which is the big powerful Madrid, it didn't work. Puigdemont has been reelected, and gosh, I mean, I hope he becomes the Skype president. That'll be a beautiful thing. Next headline: FCC considers reducing ISP licensing fees, and T-Mobile supports it. And as I've pointed out in past posts, the opponents of the net neutrality repeal have continued to put their energy into, quote, fixing the repeal by simply restoring net neutrality. And the argument made by many, especially those in the Liberty community that were against the repeal, was that regulations underneath the net neutrality regulations create protected ISP monopolies that almost assure the ISPs will abuse customers in all the ways the anti-repeal folks say they will. So my question has been this: why not put your effort to now undo the regulations that create these protected monopolies? And as it so happens, the FCC itself is considering rules changes that will make it easier for ISPs to be formed by reducing the cost of applying for ISP licensing. And this move in and of itself will not solve all the regulation monopoly problems, because there's a lot of stuff at state and local level that needs to be gutted like a fish. But it would go a long way towards undermining the state-protected monopoly status of ISPs. So let's see if the anti-repeal folks come out and support this with anywhere close to the same energy they've invested in preserving the net neutrality regulations. And then I have an excerpt here from Vice, and I'll read just a part of that. The Federal Communications Commission is currently considering a rule change that will alter how it doles out licenses for wireless spectrum. These changes would make it easier and more affordable for big telecom to scoop up licenses, while making it almost impossible for small local wireless ISPs to compete. The Citizens Broadband Radio Service spectrum is the rather earnest name for a chunk of spectrum that the federal government licenses out to businesses. It covers 35 whatever megahertz band there. You can go to the article and read it. It's 3550 to 3700, which is considered a mid-band spectrum. It can get complicated, but it helps to think of it. It helps to think of it how radio channels work. There are specific channels that can be used to broadcast, and companies buy the license. Okay, whatever. The FCC will be auctioning off licenses for this and many local wireless ISPs, internet wireless service providers that use wireless signal rather than cables to connect customers to the internet, have been hoping to buy licenses to make it easier to reach their most remote customers. And the last quote here, the vast majority of wireless ISPs are using unlicensed 5 gigahertz spectrum to connect the customer to their tower, said Jimmy Carr, the policy committee chair for the wireless internet service provider. So Vice's take is actually it's the opposite, and my take is it's not the opposite. But then I'm not a tech expert. I would appreciate your feedback. So you can respond to me on my personal Facebook page here at Paul Gordon, or our Facebook page, I State on the Facebook. Just look for iState TV. We'll go to the next headline. The laser solution to making cryptocurrencies anonymous. Lasers could create layers of encryption that could help cryptocurrencies become truly anonymous coins, and they will do it with a fraction of the energy it currently takes to encrypt data on crypto blockchains. And this story comes to us from USC Viterbi. Whatever that means, I don't know. Researchers Andrea Armani and Zhuakan Shen and Rigoberto Castro Betron and Vin M. Deep, whatever. I'm not going to name all their names. Bunch of researchers have invented a new method to create a frequency comb, a tool that increases the potential applications of lasers by converting a single wavelength into multiple wavelengths, effectively creating tens to hundreds of lasers from a single laser. The new frequency comb is the size of a human hair compared with traditional frequency combs that can be as large as an apartment refrigerator. More importantly, the newly generated comb requires 1,000 times less power to operate, allowing for mobile applications. The current state of the art relies on material systems traditionally used in microelectronics, such as silicon. By replacing these materials with carbon-based or organic molecules, a research team led by postdoctoral pursued a fundamentally different approach, attaching only a single layer of a 25-atom organic molecule to the surface of a laser. Frequency combs were demonstrated with 1,000 reduction in power. And then Professor What's-His-Face from the What's-His-Place, and you can go to hisheadlines.com to find out exactly what I'm referring to, likens the change from conventional silicon to organic materials as analogous to the change of gas to electric. At the most basic level, the process that enables the comb to be generated is distinctly different in the two material classes. Okay, so the general gist is that we're going to be able to use layers to create layers of encryption that will help nudge blockchain toward our cryptocurrencies towards truly becoming a more authentic privacy currencies or private coins, whatever they're called. Next headline. A bill to make local politicians pay if they vote against gun rights? Oh, this is pretty rich. This is from WMUR9. I'm going to read a little bit from them, and then I'm going to read my little editorial here. A bill that would put pressure on local government officials to not restrict gun rights is dividing Second Amendment groups. The bill being debated at the State House would impose penalties on local elected officials who vote to restrict gun rights. This is a constitutional right that we have that is extended to all the citizens fairly and uniformly, yet some towns decide, oh, in this town, we're not going to allow that to take place, said Representative such and such. Opponents said the bill overreaches, and officials should be able to make decisions about such things as where gun ranges can be located in their towns. And I'm not going to read any more. Here's the editor's note for this. Yes, this is a bill that is actually being introduced. The fine state of New Hampshire, the Shire, our co-host for Is Daily, Bodhi Agora, lives in the Shire, so this affects you, Bodhi. The bill would penalize local elected officials who vote to restrict the gun rights of residents. And this bill is trolley at so many levels, but man, I'm sorry, you gotta love the troll in this case. And of course, it goes without saying that the nature of the troll, that is, the targets, will probably determine the degree to which you accept the troll or not. Now, for me, well, yeah, I support this effort of trolling as it targets a group of people I consider to be perhaps one of the lowest of the low people I might put in the danger neighbor category. Ooh, I said dangerous neighbor in what I actually wrote, but I like danger neighbor. You're a danger neighbor alert, danger neighbor alert. And gun grabbers are definitely danger neighbors. These guys are the first in line to become police informants in a police state crowd. That's right. I'm talking about the gun grabbers. Now, of course, within the ostensible model of republicanism, this bill pretty much defies all those standards. But who am I, and who are you, for that matter, to stand between a bunch of statists trolling each other? Seriously, just stand back and enjoy watching a bunch of statists trolling each other and revealing to everyone the absolute absurdity of the whole affair of coercive enterprises. Just sit back and enjoy, friends. Next headline. Washington town triggers Bitcoin rush for miners. Why one small Washington town has seen so many Bitcoin miners move in. This is a fascinating story here. Salatio, this is from CNBC. Salatio is a dude that they're featuring in this story. Salcido uses 7.5 megawatts of power, enough to power 11,000 homes. He wants to produce 50 bitcoins per day by July, which will require a whopping 42 megawatts of watts of power. That's why he's in Wenatchee. That's why he's in Wenatchee. Power is extremely cheap, between 2 to 3 cents per kilowatt hour. And the reason? A series of dams on the Columbia River provide abundant hydroelectric power. But it's not just the cheap power. Cooler temperatures help keep the servers at the right temperature. And for a small town, Wenatchee has great internet capacity. So we have not only low-cost electricity, but also very good access to the internet, says Wright. People put those two together and think, opportunity for Bitcoin? So here you have it, folks. What I am going to classify as the great Bitcoin rush. Now, they're using it for Bitcoin, but does it have to be for Bitcoin? This could become the great cryptocurrency rush of what? I gotta look up the name. I can't remember that name. That's not a name that fits within the parameter of words that I usually use because, you know, I have a very narrow cultural perspective, of course. That goes without saying. Wenatchee. The great cryptocurrency rush of 2018. So you had the 49ers in 1849. Now you have the 18ers. Maybe someday they'll have a football team called the 18ers. And I'll probably hate them as much as I hate the 49ers because, yes, I definitely hate the 49ers. This is since I was a kid, so it has nothing to do with any of the NFL protests or anything, the 49ers are on my list of teams I love to hate, with the number one team I love to hate being the Dallas Cowboys. Totally unrelated to all of this, but there you go. Our next headline, and actually, I hope we get to these. We got three headlines in a row here, all related to Turkey. So this one is the delicate alliance of Russia, Turkey, and Iran. Syria has brought three nations together, Russia, Turkey, and Iran. But the unfolding dynamic of Syria may be the undoing of the very alliance Syria helped to form. And this is from Ashark Alausart. So they write, Ankara, Moscow, and Tehran have other reasons to seek a quick end, or at least fudging up of the Syrian imbroglio. Turkish President Erdogan is facing a problematic presidential election year under a new constitution that replaces the parliamentary system with a presidential one, concentrating power in the hands of whoever becomes president. A candidate himself, Erdogan, is almost certain of winning, but the question is by what percentage? A feeble turnout and a slim majority would not give him the moral mandate and political authority to embark upon his grand design, whatever. Russian President Putin is also facing a presidential election, and he too is almost certain win. But he's also concerned about the shape and size of his victory. He does not wish to end his 30-year career as master of Russia's destiny with the lowest backing from the electorate. With Russia's economy in doldrums and the Western powers unwilling to grant Russia equal status as a major power, Putin needs a big victory, which would be Syria. So, okay, it didn't really put in the Iran perspective here, but really the linchpin point, and if you click on the article, you'll see more about this. They all want this conflict to end quickly. However, there's a big setback, and it has to do with the Kurds. The Turks remain implacable. No negotiation for the Kurds. They don't want the Kurds to exist as any kind of political entity. As a matter of fact, well, let's get to our next headline here. Turkey threatens to invade Rojava again. Now, Rojava is a sort of stateless region. It's a fascinating experiment going on there that kind of follows a lot of the teachings indirectly of Murray Bookchin. So I've been watching it very carefully, but Turkey doesn't like it. So Erdogan once again is repeating his threat of invading the self-administered Kurdish region in northern Syria. Now, this goes against what the Russians have already said, that, hey, man, they want these Kurds to exist. They don't want them to go away, and they want them to maintain their semi-autonomous status within Syria. And even Assad has kind of said, well, you know, all right. You know, the thing about the Kurdish Syrians is they haven't been militant other than protecting themselves, mostly from ISIS and from opposition, whatever. Well, really, ISIS and Turkey is who they have to protect themselves against. But they're being very careful in keeping their focus on Rojava. That's why they have the name Rojava. They're not trying to join the larger Turkish call to a larger Kurdistan, whatever, that spans territory in Turkey, Syria, and Iraq. They're just focused on Rojava. They're trying to stay out of all that other stuff. And so Assad is looking at them as like, okay, they seem to be willing to pay a little tribute. And the Russians seem to like them there. They get a lot of support from the Americans as well. So this sticking point, it's really the Kurdish question that undermines the current alliance between Russia, Turkey, and Iran. We get to our last Turkish story here. Turkey calls in U.S. envoy to protest support for Syrian Kurds. By Syrian Kurds, we're talking about Rojava. Turkey is not happy that the U.S. continued to support and arm Syrian Kurdish fighters, and their foreign ministry has summoned the top U.S. diplomat in the country to voice its discomfort over the situation. So there you have it. Keep a close watch on that alliance, if it can hold together. And it really, there's so much in the Middle East right now, not all of it, but so much of it that's actually swirls around Turkey and around the Kurdish question. So we're going to just name a few other quick headlines here. So we have U.S. court upholds Missouri law requiring licensing for African-style hair braiders. That means if you want to open up a shop in which all you're doing is braiding hair, African-style braiding hair, the federal appeals court has upset a Missouri law requiring you to go through all kinds of schooling, raising the cost of entry, basically, for you to be able to braid somebody else's hair. Let's get to this one here. Facebook newsfeed algorithm to reduce non-family friend results in feed. So Mark Zuckerberg wants to redesign Facebook to produce different results. He wants Facebook to be less of a marketing tool and a source for news and more of a tool for simply authentically connecting to family and friends. To that end, Facebook is changing its newsfeed algorithm to produce more results from friends and family than from news sources and business. Interestingly, I find again and again more people are interested not so much in connected to family and friends on Facebook, because they're getting a lot of political and otherwise religious fights because people are starting to become more aware of how people actually think. They actually want to connect to other people. So they want to see news and all that. So good luck, Mark. Good luck with that. I have a feeling that Minds.com is going to get a lot of new business thanks to some of the decisions that you're making. So some of the headlines that didn't make it on the top chart there or the top listing there. Prime numbers could possibly offer solutions to Bitcoin's electrical problem. MoneyGram to pilot Ripple's XRP token. The robot who Chrissy Teigen trolled is coming for her now, and that's Sophia. And finally, national background checks near at all. Well, I'm out of time. I can't figure it. Can I cheat? I'm going to cheat. I'm going to go ahead and cheat, and I'm going to add national background checks near all-time high. That means a lot of people are buying guns, so that's essentially what that means. So this has been headlines you may have missed on my Facebook page, my personal Facebook page. If you're listening to this on the tubes of you, or if you're listening to the audio version, you look me up, Paul Gordon. And I believe right now it's the picture. I'm wearing a vest kind of outfit, so you can figure that out, and I wear glasses. And if I look at your Facebook page and it's not too creepy or looks trolly or you got nothing going on, if it's not those things, I will friend you back. But other than that, when I do these, I set my setting to global so anybody can see this anyway. I will be back doing headlines you may have missed the Monday, and this is Monday through Friday that this show happens, 12:30 p.m., and I'm about ready to go on over to the Sovereign Individual, the Sovereign Individual, that's the name of one of my favorite books, the Sovereignty Network Facebook page, because I watch Crypto Corner live with Kurt Walker Jr., and he's given me a good education of what's going on in cryptocurrency-topia, and maybe crypto diptopia as well. Crypto dystopia. We don't have an Is Daily show tonight. Is Daily is only Monday through Thursday, but we will be back on the Liberty Principle Facebook page for Is Daily Monday with myself and Professor Rambo, where we will be talking Full Auto. That's where we talk about guns. We're going to be doing iWorld. That's where we look at those world news stories that maybe other people aren't talking about. And then finally, we end with a little iPrepper. So that's it. The show is over. Thank you for watching this show. And be sure to go to isheadlines.com to get access to all the archives of the shows, which include the YouTube embed, the Facebook embed, and the audio version of the show as well. My name is Paul Gordon with iState.tv. I'll see you on Monday.